Hello and welcome. Thanks to HarperCollins, our very special guest on QBD Crime Club is a gentleman who has led a life that is the stuff of fiction, as enthralling as his books. It is such a great pleasure to welcome from London the legendary Geoffrey Archer. Hello.
Good morning, Victoria, in my country, and good heaven knows what time it is in your country.
Yes, indeed. Good evening, late afternoon for me. Thank you so much for chatting to us. We are, of course, talking about the fourth instalment in this series. But before we talk about the book, we wanted to talk about you because I know so many Australian fans will be wondering what you've been up to. And in the strange pandemic times we live in, you haven't stopped writing. You've been as busy as ever.
Well, I suppose a writer has a great advantage during this terrible COVID period. Mary and I were locked down in Cambridge, whereas she couldn't run the Science Museum, which she's chairman of. I could get on with my writing. And the result was that instead of going to Mallorca, as I normally do, I remained in Cambridge and just didn't stop writing. I had the idea for Over My Dead Body. So I was very lucky and privileged.
Because we obviously in Australia, we've had no overseas travel. I know it's been quite different in a lot of ways where you are. But I was wondering, because it is such a tradition for you, isn't it, for where you begin your books and do your first drafts?
Yes, it was. Yes, it is. But that didn't make any difference because Cambridge, my home in Cambridge, is lovely. And on your other comment, Victoria, I spoke to your High Commissioner yesterday, George Brandreth, an outstanding man and much liked in England. And he was telling me that New South Wales have made a big step forward in the last 24 hours. And he was hoping everything would now speed up because you've reached 80% on the jab front, which is very good news all round. And it, much more important, it means our cricket team can come to Australia, hammer you into the dust and then return.
Are you sure they'll all come? They're not afraid?
Oh, I'm sure they will come. I'm not sure they will hammer you into the dust.
No. Yeah, I would like to argue that point, absolutely. Geoffrey, I wonder, I don't think there's a decent bookshelf. I'm seeing a wonderful bookshelf behind you, but any decent bookshelf anywhere around the world would have one of your books on it. I wonder, though, over the years, has your audience changed? Are you finding newer, younger readers, and do they pick up one of these and then go back and find a classic? Is the audience changing and growing all the time?
Oh, yes, and I'm very aware in India, when I do a tour there, that the schools ask me to speak because they've all read Cain and Abel. And so you know that it's starting at a young age, and you're quite right. An author doesn't want to only, I'm 81 years old. An author doesn't want people only of his own age. So yes, you're quite right. I stretch out to the young all the time, and nothing is more touching than a 14, 15, 16-year-old saying, I'm reading your books.
That is fantastic. I think these days as well, of course, with social media, and I know that you're very active on the platforms, fans can reach out to you directly, can't they, and let you know what they're thinking and how they're feeling. And in a lot of ways, that's how the William Warwick books came about, because people were giving you such great feedback when he appeared in the Clifton Chronicles.
You're quite right, Victoria. At the end of the Clifton Chronicles, I was receiving letters saying, we want to know about William Warwick, Harry Clifton's eponymous hero. And I sat down and thought about that. And I realized, of course, that the crime front is very well covered. There's a lot of leading authors in that field. And so I had to approach it from a different angle and decided that I would write a story, not a detective story, but a story about a detective. And that would be the difference. While William Warwick was at school, he wants to join the Metropolitan Police. His father wants him to go to Oxford and read law. He's a distinguished QC and wants him to join him in chambers. But William stands firm, leaves school, goes to London University and reads art, and then joins the Metropolitan Police as a constable on the beat. And in book one, Nothing Ventured, you see him as a constable on the beat. And what you're going to get, Victoria, is every book will be a book in its own right. So it's not a series in that way. And no, every book, he will be a different rank, and every book will be a different subject. So the first book, Nothing Ventured, is art fraud. And the second book is drugs. The third book is Police Corruption, and the book you have behind you is, over my dead body, is four unsolved murder cases that the commander has put him onto and said, if people get away with murder, they might do it again. And they've given him the tough job of following up four murder cases. Now, in each book, he will go up one rank. So in Nothing Ventured, he starts as a detective constable on the beat. In the second book, he's a detective sergeant. In the third book, he's a detective inspector. And in this book, he's a detective chief inspector. And he will, Victoria, he will become the commissioner of the Metropolitan Police in four books' time, as long as I live to the age of 86.
I do love that. I love that there's kind of a destiny there, that you know it's coming. But you know what's really interesting when you read him? You feel as though he could be any age. So I understand he's quite, you know, reasonably young, but he's in a lot of ways, at times when you're reading with his knowledge and his wisdom, you think he could be so much older. And that's it's really nice because you feel like you're in safe hands with him.
Well, he's based on a remarkable man who's my chief researcher, a man called a former Detective Chief Superintendent John Sutherland, who sadly left the Metropolitan Police when he was in charge of the murder squad. He had a breakdown, a mental breakdown, in which he described as one murder too many. And he's my chief researcher, and he's assisted by a brilliant young woman, also retired from the force after 30 years, called Michelle Roycroft. And Michelle was in the drug squad. So I've got this amazing combination of a very senior man who was heading towards becoming commissioner and this very able woman who worked in the drug squad for 30 years.
And then you have, of course, all of your knowledge about all of the other areas, be it art, be it the, you know, the aristocracy, all the other parts. And I guess that's why, in a lot of ways, you know, it's a fiction story, but it's so authentic because you have that wonderful background knowledge that's been your life, but also those that you've got around you helping with the research.
I've been very privileged in my life meeting some fascinating and interesting people. And you're quite right. My love of art, my love of politics, my love of sport, and my auctioneering all come into the book. So when young people come to me and say, Geoffrey, I want to be a writer, I say, well, write about what you know about, because the public will realize. And I had a lady the other day came to see me and said, oh, well, it's not fair, Geoffrey. You've met everybody. You know everybody. I said, well, what do you do? She said, I work in a hairdresser. And I said, there are more stories in a hairdresser on a daily basis than I would ever be able to find.
So it is fair to say that a fair bit of your lived experience does find its way onto the pages.
I think that's true for every book. If you look at every first novel, if you go back to Not a Penny More, Not a Penny Less, when I'd lost my fortune, well, I'd lost a lot of money and had to start life again, it's pretty well a true story, Not a Penny More, Not a Penny Less. And I think most first novels are autobiographical. You then have to move on. And so I've now been writing, as you know, Victoria, for 45 years. But the big breakthrough was Cain and Abel. That changed my life literally overnight. They sold 1 million copies in the first week. And my life as a writer, as that was the big moment. So I've been very privileged. I met a very interesting lady on Sunday who was interviewing me at a Henley Book Festival. And she said, how long did the breakthrough take? Because my fourth book is just coming out. And I said, well, I was lucky on my third, but it's usually 3, 4, or 5 where the big breakthrough comes through. And then people go back and buy the earlier books.
And then, of course, the expectation comes, and you've managed with that to be able over the years to keep producing wonderful books that people want to read. I think what was wonderful about this...
Before you go on with that, Victoria, that's not as easy as it looks.
Oh, I'm not suggesting that.
Under pressure. once you've been to number one on the New York Times, you're under a degree of pressure that... And I think I will stop writing the day there's no stories coming through. I'm at the moment very lucky. The stories are in my mind every single day. but I have great sympathy with. My agent once told me that he has authors who say, I don't know what to do next. I've never had that problem, but I can understand if you've just had a success and things are going well, the publisher's saying, where's the next one? And if you haven't got a book or haven't got an idea, that must be a tremendous pressure.
And as you say, 45 years of doing this, the industry itself has changed quite a lot as well. So you've managed to kind of ride that wave and that tide as well.
Well, if you look at the industry, you're quite right, Victoria. When I set out, we had hardbacks and paperbacks. And then we got those sort of bigger softbacks. And then we Kindle and Amazon came along and the world changed. Then audios came along. And I have to tell you, 10 years ago, if you'd looked at my book sales, they were 100% hardback and softback. And then suddenly you got 1% audio. Along came Kindle, and that's now 40% of my market. But hold your breath. Audio has gone from 1% to 9% in Britain. It's a big market nowadays. And I was on the dental chair the other day being killed yet again when my dentist said, love the last book, Geoffrey. And I said, how did you read? He said, oh, I have a home in the West Country and I never read you. I listen to you in the car on the way down and I listen to you in the car on the way back. So you're quite right, Victoria. There's a whole new world out there.
Tell us about when you were putting this story together, because as you said, there are several murders in here, but there are so many stories along the way that take us. I really love where you began on the cruise ship and young James Buchanan. I feel like there's a series in James Buchanan as well.
Well, that was a risk in itself, because if you start a book, I mean, the main purpose was for William Warwick to discover that the wicked Faulkner was still alive. That was the big deal in that, but it turned into something totally different when the whole book opens with the words, if I remember correctly, the whole book opens with the words, are you a detective, sir? William looked up at the young man who asked the question. No, I'm the assistant manager of the Midland Bank in Shoreham, Kent. If that's the case, continued the young man, not looking convinced, you'll be able to tell me the exchange rate was between the dollar and the pound when the currency market opened this morning. Well, now, you set off in one direction and you think, well, that's good for three or four pages. That turned out to be good for 70 pages because a murder takes place on board the cruise ship he's having his holiday on, and the young man becomes an integral part in solving who committed the murder. So sometimes an author is swept away by something he hadn't originally intended, because the original intention, as I said, Victoria, was for him to go on that ship and discover that Faulkner was still alive. And that still remained a very important factor, but we got a separate story in between.
But I think it also gave a chance to, if someone, as you said, each book is, even though it's the same character, it's a standalone, it also gave you a chance to get to know William and his wife, Beth, who I adored. I just love that relationship and I love her as a character. It sort of allowed you to also get to know them independently before they went back and faced what they had to face back home.
Well, of course, Beth is replaced on my wife, Mary, who's currently chairman of the Science Museum and before that chaired the great hospital, Cambridge, Adam Brooks, a very strong woman who's still working flat out. And I had a very strong mother, and I had the honor and privilege of working with Margaret Thatcher for 11 years. So that combination makes it fairly easy for me to write about strong women, not least because I like strong women. And so Beth, you're quite right. Beth is a big factor in this book with a twist that I hope will shock the public. One member of the public has already written in their review, I stopped breathing at that point. So we hope that there's one or two shocks in this book.
Oh, there absolutely are. And I also think that's quite interesting when you, because it is, it's at times terribly polite. And then all of a sudden when a little bit of violence occurs or things happen, then it is quite shocking. And I think that what you've done beautifully is you've jarred us several times in different ways, and because there are so many characters that have so much going on.
It's very important to bring, to make the reader feel they know the people, yeah, and they are not friends, but part of their life. They once did a survey, and I couldn't understand why they did it, but they did it. They once did a survey with 1,000 people who'd never read me and asked what they liked most or what they disliked most. And I assumed that they would come out top would be storytelling. I had no doubt in my mind storytelling would be top. It wasn't. Character was top. They liked the characters in the book and got involved with the characters in the book. So in the Clifton Chronicles, and I hope in the William Warwick series, you become part of the family. And then the storytelling was actually a very close second, but it was second.
It's really interesting. And I suppose then that makes sense to me, because you talk about Ross, who's another character who's very important in this book as well. And you are drawn into each of those characters because they all have their own parts to play and their own stories. And that's one of the things about William in this book, isn't it? He's not just worrying about his own patch and what he has to deal with. He's got a lot of people keeping his team on track as well is the big challenge for him.
Well, he's a leader of men, and he has around him a very remarkable team, or all human beings with their own problems. But in the end, he's the boss, and he has to make the decisions, and he has to take the blame if it goes wrong. And I've always thought that is fascinating, because again, I've had the privilege of working with great leaders. I worked with for 11 years with Margaret Thatcher and 10 years with John Major, and indeed in your own country, I had the privilege of knowing and working with John Howard, a remarkable leader. And so I've seen great leaders in my own lifetime. So when I write about leadership, I know what some of these people have been through.
And how important is that to you, to be able to kind of instill that and to show that in such an important role and still doing a really hard job, that you can still be such a great leader?
I think that's the fun. I think you've got to have the two. In a way, the leadership mustn't be spelt out on the page. It must be obvious to the reader. The story must sweep you along. And the fact that you've raised the leadership is fascinating in itself, Victoria, because I don't do it purposely. I try to do it so that it is assimilated in the book, no more than part of the book.
It is interesting because you, as you say, when you talk about finding out that Miles is alive and where the story takes us after that, you do spend a lot of time wondering who's on whose side, because there are a lot of characters at play out there, and you're never quite sure till you get right towards the end who's with who.
Well, I suppose that's my political background. You're never sure who's on your side. But I once said that to John Sutherland, and he said it's exactly the same in the police force. You're never quite sure who's on your side. And I suspect it's true in big business. I suspect it's true in many fields. I remember in the days when I was a runner, I found it very hard to be friends with my greatest rivals, those people who were trying also to get in the British team at that particular time. And I think that's very human. And what you see, I hope, in Over My Dead Body or any of the William Warwick series, is that each one of the people who's surrounding him in the team is ambitious. They one day want to be in his job, and maybe one day they will make it, but they can't all make it. And you have to be aware of that in real life. For example, your job is a classic example. Everyone watching this program thinks they can do your job, and everyone thinks it's easy. And the reason they think it's easy is because you make it look easy. And a writer has to do the same thing. They have to make it look easy. I had dinner yesterday with a leading publisher who kindly made a very kind remark that I realized. She said, whenever you speak, you make it look as if it's casual. And I said, I rehearse everything. I write everything. I work very hard. I wish it was just easy to do. And that you know in your job, and I know in mine, because Over My Dead Body, you read the 14th draft, every one handwritten. I wish I could knock out one draft and then go on holiday.
Do you ever, I mean, you say the 14th draft, have you ever, is there a record in there? Have you ever nailed it on the 10th, or is it always get right up there?
I'm afraid it does go around the 13th, 14th every time. You don't know until you're only changing one word every two or three pages and maybe adding one sentence every 20 pages. That's when you know you're there. That's when you know you must show it to your editor and see what they think. But until that moment, if you're still changing whole paragraphs, you're still moving things, you're not there. And anyone listening to this program who wants to be a writer, here's two pieces of advice. You haven't finished the book when you've finished the first draft. You've probably got the story down on paper, but that's when the hard work begins. The second piece of advice, Victoria, is don't show it to your wife, don't show it to your husband, don't show it to your girlfriend, don't show it to your boyfriend, don't show it to your mother. They will all lie. They will all say it's the next best seller. You can't fail. Show it to a friend and say, please get someone I've never met to read it and give a one-page report. Then you might get the truth.
Ah, that is fantastic advice. I love it. I'm loving that you're still handwriting everything.
Yes, I'm a pathetic old-fashioned thing. There is my felt tip pen. It moves across the paper. I can't type. I can't use a laptop. I can just about turn the light on. So I am still writing every single word. And I mentioned this to the lady who was interviewing me the other day, and she was only, I would say, 35. And she said, I'm the same. So there's still a lot of writers who prefer to actually use the pen.
That is very interesting. You give us some great insights, as I said a little bit earlier, in Over My Dead Body. We see the police force and the legal structure around it. It was almost casual the way the bribery went on and the underhand and the way everybody was watching everybody. And I think it almost felt acceptable because of the way it felt. But I guess that's what you've seen.
Well, that's the advantage of having John Sutherland and Michelle Roycroft on my team. They can stop me making silly mistakes, and they can say, actually, when I was in the force, this happened and this happened and this happened. And that helps a great deal because it's very interesting you put it that way, because you've almost got to make it look casual. Yeah. You mustn't make it look as if it's some big deal, because if it looks casual and feels casual, the reader will say, I believe this. I think this is possible. You mustn't have the reader say, I couldn't believe a word of it.
The four stories, the four, you know, the unsolved crimes that our team are trying to solve. It was wonderful the way it wrapped up, because obviously we're not going to give anything away, but those four stories, as they culminate towards the end, it just keeps you on edge the whole time, because there's the story that, you know, what William's doing, but then there's these four cases as well. And it is quite the climax, isn't it, when you get towards the end and all of this is happening at once.
As a writer, you should set up the story, take them through, and frankly, the last 100 pages should be at 100 miles an hour.
It was.
That is what I aim for. Whether you achieve it or not, it's another thing altogether. But I certainly set out, when you come to that key moment, when you realize the four murders are interlinked, that is the moment. I think you've got to take them from that page to the last at 100 miles an hour, and they mustn't put the book down.
You take us, of course, again into the art world. I know it's a great love of yours. You get people sort of that are experts themselves as well, that are coming to you with information, or are they loving the insights that this beautiful art history is making it inside a detective story or a story about a detective?
Well, I go back to the point earlier, Victoria, you should write about what you know about. And I love art. I've had a passion of it. For it since an early age, when I fell in love with a girl who was reading art history at Bristol University, and she had no interest in me at all. And so I fell out of love with her and fell in love with her subject, art, and have been collecting ever since. I can't stop. I'm just love it. So of course it gets into the books. And if I may say so, in the home I'm sitting here in London, I have at least six Australian paintings. I'm a huge admirer of Boyd. I think he's a truly great artist. And of course, Nolan and others, and Bunny, I have. All because of a man called Philip Bacon from Brisbane.
Brisbane, yes.
I think he has one of the best art galleries on earth I've ever seen. And his sheer knowledge I would never have discovered Australian art without him. And he's given me a passion also for Australian art.
Oh, that is absolutely fantastic. So if you're writing about what you know, might we see William Warwick heading to the cricket at some stage, or where might we see him?
Well, now there is a problem for silly people like you and other silly Australians, God bless you all, is I wouldn't sell many books in America.
True.
If there was a big cricket, but I'll let you into a secret. The next book, which I'm working on at the moment, does have a cricket match in it. It is only 10 pages because you can't. Whereas the other extreme, of course, is India. I mean, I'm welcomed in India. Whenever I go on television, my publisher says, please talk about the book. And I say, no, I'm not going to talk about the book. I'm going to talk about Indian cricket. I'm going to talk about all the great captains I knew. I was at Oxford with the Nawab of Patodi 60 years ago, right through to Kohli. And of course, I get invited onto every single show because I talk about the cricket, which the Indians are passionate about. And it doesn't do the books any harm, Victoria.
I'm sure. Well, not if the children are reading Cain and Abel, quite clearly not. It's having an impact.
Yes, absolutely.
Wonderful.
I love India, and it's always lovely when, in fact, I think, dare I say it to an Australian, I think the greatest test match I've ever listened to on the radio was India versus Australia when Rahul Dravid and VVS Laxman followed on and batted all day and beat you. That's what cricket is about. And that's why we love it, because it's so unpredictable.
And do you know, so I actually by trade am a sports journalist. And when I remember when I first started working in sport, when I was taught about cricket, when you actually learn and understand what a test match is and why it's so special, and all the short forms of the game now are so popular and there's so much going on, but the long form of the game is truly just so special and unique. So, I understand exactly why you say that about that match.
Well, you say that, but sadly, I think it's in demise. I think the 220 is taking over, which I hate. I'm a test match lover. I hate the idea that it's taking over the world. There was a match last year between South Africa and New Zealand where they didn't know what the result would be, a tie, a draw, a win or a lose, until the last six overs, after 5 days.
Right, yeah.
So when Americans say to me, what do you mean, Jeffrey? You can play 5 days of cricket and have a draw and you enjoy it? I say, yes, yes, poor Americans, they don't understand, God bless them.
Well, I'm pleased that cricket will make an appearance in the next book. So this is number four. Are you sticking to seven? Will we have seven William Warwick books?
I think it looks like seven or eight. I think in the next book, he'll be a superintendent, then he'll be a chief superintendent, then he'll be a commander, then he'll be commissioner of the Metropolitan Police. But as I said, Victoria, and you clearly weren't listening, I've got to live to the age of 86 to make it.
I'm guessing that that will all happen and it will all be okay. There's no trouble there at all. We are so thrilled that you could join us. Congratulations on the new book, Over My Dead Body. I know everyone is going to love it. And we're so pleased you could join us. And thank you so very much.
Thank you very much, Victoria. Privileged to be on your show.